This book was written back in 1999, so it doesn't God, would you forgive us one more time? And Samson put his arms up against the pillars, and he said, God, just one more time, would you give me my strength back? Just one more time. And the Bible says that Samson began to push on those pillars. And he knew what was going to happen. But as he began to push, the great pillars were moved, and the grandstands of made of marble and cut out rock and all began to fall. And that entire stadium fell that day, and more people were killed in that last act of Samson. Guys, here's where I am. Two little things I wanted to read today. Election of Godly Leaders and Prayer for Christians to Vote. This book written in 1999. Just some great words here. Father, I desire to vote intelligently in all elections. I pray that you will bring to light the things I need to know so I may vote in line with your plan, your will, and purpose. May things not only come to light for the Christian community, but may things be made clear to the unbelieving community as well. I pray that what is right would be so clear that even unbelievers would vote using wisdom and demanding honesty and uprightness from their politicians. Dear Father, in the name of Jesus, may the citizens of our nation become so weary of sin and degradation in our nation's leaders that they will begin to seek out godly leaders to represent them on every level of government. Give such leaders favor with the public and the media. Father, make our nation a fragrance in the earth, a force to be reckoned with, a hand extended to those in need. Dear Father, I do not take lightly what you have done in our nation. I appreciate not only the right, but the privilege I have to vote. I pray that I, as well as others, will use that privilege wisely, seeking your will as we consider the qualifications of those for whom we are to vote. I pray for my Christian family, the body of Christ, that they receive the right to vote as a gift from your hand and avail themselves of this opportunity. May there arise such a force of righteousness in our electoral system that it would affect every realm and every level of government in our nation. I pray in Jesus' name that the powers that be would gain a profound respect not only for the political strength of the Christian community, but for our spiritual influence in our nation as well. A prayer now by John Wanamaker, American merchant and U.S. Postmaster General from 1889 to 1893. O Lord, thou hast taught us help us to shut the door, shutting out the world and the enemy and any fear or doubt which spoils prayer. May there be no distance between our souls and thee. John Wanamaker. Would you bow with me in prayer? Heavenly Father, I thank you today for your great grace and your love. I thank you for this time, God, again this Sunday that we are able to gather on the inside of the walls of God. And God, we realize that this pandemic, God, this COVID-19 has continued to spread, and that even at this time, God, across this city, Lord, there are many cases and all that we have heard this morning that some of our fellow sister churches, God, in our community here have been hit, God, with this disease. We pray, O God, for your divine protection. This morning, as I did in my house this morning, I pray again, O God, for your divine hedge of protection around our families and Bethel Church. And O God, I pray for others around us today and for your hedge of protection, God, that our community at large, God, and our state and our nation, O God, would be rid of this pestilence that is coming. God, for whatever reasons, you have, by your righteous thoughts and your great knowledge, far greater than ours, God, you have allowed this to happen. But, oh God, we pray for your divine hand, and we plead the precious blood of Jesus in defense of all of the enemy's attacks, God, that would come against us. We pray as did David alone, and given him several options, God, you gave him several options. And he chose, God, that he would rather leave his destiny in your hand than to choose his own judgment. God, today we leave our destiny. We leave our health, our life, our strength, our ministry as a church and all that we are in your righteous hand. We agree with Abraham alone, God, who said, shall not the judge of all the earth do that which is right. God, we will not ever, hopefully ever, question your divine ways and judgment. But, oh God, we plead this morning for your mercy and your forgiveness, God, of our sins, individually and collectively here in Bethel Church against you, oh God. We pray for our leaders, we pray for our country, and God, we pray for what to Jesus was the main thing, the great commission to go into all the world and preach the gospel there and preach it, God. I pray that our missions conference and missions emphasis, which we are already in, God, would make a profound difference in the hearts and lives of many who yet have not come to Christ. Take this service this morning. Direct your words to our hearts, O God. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to invite you this morning to take your Bibles and join me in the Old Testament. In the book of Numbers, over in the book of Numbers, chapter 11, the Bible says that when the children of Israel left the land of Egypt, and this is kind of a reminder to us as we journey through this old sinful world that we live in today, it's not just us born-again believers who are walking through this old world, but the Bible says, just like the children of Israel had a group that are called in the Bible the mixed multitude. The mixed multitude didn't love God like the Jews did. They had no knowledge of God like the Jews did. And whereas God did great work in the Israelites, the people of Israel, it was always a reluctant remnant out there that kept pulling God's people down, pulling them down, constantly complaining, constantly griping, constantly blaming God, constantly sinning in one way or the other. And not only were they doing it, but they were trying to pull down all of God's people down to their level. Now the Bible says that we are not to love the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. And so we know that we have relationships and friendships and sometimes family relationships and sometimes friendship where we work and people around us who don't love God, who don't want Jesus, and they don't want to hear about Jesus. But look what happened in Numbers 11. Verse 1, it says, and the people complained, and it displeased the Lord, and the Lord heard it. And his anger was kindled, and the fire of the Lord burned among them, and consumed them that were in the uttermost parts of the camp. And the people cried unto Moses, and when Moses prayed unto the Lord, the fire was quenched. And he called the name of the place Taberah, because the fire of the Lord burned among them. And the mixed multitude that was among them fell a-lusting. And the children of Israel also wept again. You see, the Israelites got caught up in the murmuring, grumbling, and complaining against God and God's ways. And they began to cry out along with the mixed multitude, who shall give us flesh to eat? What were they doing? They said, God, we're sick and tired of this bread that falls from heaven every night. And we're sick and tired of living on what you're giving us. Who will give us flesh to eat? We remember. Then they start going back and say, hey guys, remember the good free. Boy, I tell you, all you got to do to make people happy, free food. Free food. We remember the fish fries. Oh, good old fish fries we used to have. And we did eat in Egypt free. Remember those cucumbers out of my garden? Woo, got the best cucumbers. Oh, I'd give $100 for a cucumber right now. All I've got is a man. And they just began to complain. Hey, guys, you were finding yourself complaining against your father. It may not be what you want. The old song said it. It may not come when you want it. But he'll be there right on time. Because he's an on-time God. Yes, he is. He's not only an on-time God, he is an always correct God. His ways are higher than my ways. And his thoughts are higher than your thoughts and our thoughts. Oh, we remember the cucumbers and the melons and the leeks and the onions. Oh, I love onions. I almost had to beat my oldest son when he was a kid. And I was with him last week out in Arkansas. The boy eats them like apples. Now he picks them up like I do. We love onions, but I'm going to tell you, when he was a kid, he couldn't get it. And the leeks and the onions and the garlics, it says down, but now our soul is dried away, and there is nothing at all beside this manna before our eyes. And the manna looked like a coriander seed, and the color thereof, the color of the deluge. And the people went about and gathered it, and they ground it in mills, they beat it in a mortar, and they baked it in cans and made cakes of it, and the taste of it was as the taste of fresh oil. And when the dew fell upon the camp at night, the manna fell upon it. Then Moses heard the people cry, weep throughout their families. Every man in the door of his tent, people cried, oh, would you just have some onions and fried fish and leeks and garlic and cucumber? And the anger of the Lord was kindled greatly. Moses also was displeased. And guys, I want to tell you, don't you know, as we enter this mission, world mission season again, we're coming up on the month of December where we always have our lot of Christmas offering. And the largest gift given to world missions across the entire Southern Baptist Convention comes out of the Lyman Christmas offering that individual churches all across the Southern Baptist Convention merge together, and hundreds of millions of dollars come in to support world missions. But in a time of this, and most mission conferences take place in the fall or the winter months. And as we come to our missions conference, where we're focusing on our faith promise missionaries, people that go into the jungles and the villages and the small and distant places. Next Sunday morning, you guys are going to get to hear Finney Matthews from India. His father pastored in India for many, many years, and he is a great friend with Chuck and Sabrina Campbell, and he's just a great guy to talk to on the telephone and all, and I will tell you, great accomplishments in his ministry. He'll be speaking next Sunday morning, and you're going to hear Daryl and Danielle Renshaw, who work with Transworld Radio, TWR. Daryl and Danielle, they were military people, and they got out. Daryl became a businessman, and then he was a deacon in my church in Florida for several years, and now for the last 11 years, Daryl and Danielle have been working with TWR, Transworld Radio, sending the gospel into millions and billions of people where missionaries are not allowed. And the missionary stories going in the language of the people being broadcast into the nations of the world. You're going to meet Daryl and Danielle next Sunday morning. You're going to get to hear from Peter and Vivian Morgan next Sunday morning. Peter and Viviana are islanders from the island of St. Lucia, Bahamas. They have been dear friends of mine, and I've worked with them for several years. And they have gone to begin a work and a school, and they built a church. And they are tremendous people, and they and we're just excited about that and looking forward to what God's going to do. But you know, when Jesus said, "Follow me," following Christ, here's what it is not. Following Christ doesn't mean that when I come to Christ, I say, "Oh, I'm going to follow my dreams. I'm going to reach for the stars. I'm going to pursue now my goals and my ambitions. As a Christian, I'm going to pursue my dreams and my goals." And oh, wait a minute. That's not what Jesus said. Sometimes we're like little kids, little 5 and 6 year old kids. And I used to have a group called Pastor's Pals. I'd interview them every Sunday. And I'd say, "What do you want to be when you grow up?" "Oh, I want to be a trash man. I want to be, what do you want to do? I want to be a dog walker." You know, you ask little kids, 5 and 6 and 7 and 8 and 19 and 20, "What do you want to do with your life?" I want to tell you what, you don't know where you're going to go. Because some people, it has been drilling some people, you can do anything you want to do. You can go anywhere you want to go. You can reach for the stars you want to reach for. And you can achieve the goals you want to reach for. But I'm asking, child of God, have you considered that the God who loved you and the God who died for you on the cross said, "Follow me and I will make you to become fishers of men"? And I always tell you people, God reserves the very best in life for those who leave the choice and direction up to Him. And when you and I, at any age you may be, you will never go wrong when you leave your destiny, both eternal destiny, your ambition and goals for what you have that you want to do. I went over two or three weeks ago, I went over to Bristol, Tennessee. Bill Howe was a young man who, the first time I ever met Bill, he was a young high school or college student. He had come into my church at Florida, and I met Bill after the service. And he came back and he told me that he was living in the area and all, he wanted to start coming to the church. I said, "Well, great, son." I said, "I'd like to get with you, get to know you." And I said, "Well, what are you going to do?" He said, "I've always wanted to be an attorney." And he was telling me about it. He was going to be studying law and all like that. But when I went to see Bill 2 or 3 weeks ago to make a presentation in his church in Bristol, Virginia, to him that Sunday morning after he finished preaching, Bill and Susie took us out to lunch afterwards. And Bill said to me, "Brother Charlie, do you remember the first time we met?" He said, "I had it in my heart that I wanted to be an attorney. I want to be a lawyer." But he said, in just a short time, under the word of God, God began to change my want to's. And God very clearly, one Sunday morning, He spoke His word to my heart. And He said that He had different plans for my life. He wanted me to go into the ministry. And so He enlisted in Trinity College of Florida. He graduated there 4 years later, went to seminary in Louisville, and then transferred to Mid-America Seminary with Adrian Rogers back in the following years. Graduated, got his doctorate degree, and he's been pastor in Bristol, Virginia, and Bristol, Tennessee for the last 25 years. But Bill said, "Charlie," he said, I'll never be able to thank God enough and thank you enough, because he said, "You challenged me. Are you doing what you want to do, or are you doing what God wants you to do?" And he said, "When God spoke to my heart, it became obvious that what God was doing, God was changing my want-tos." I want to tell you, we need people in every walk of life. When you are walking in God's will, if you're an electrician, a plumber, a block mason, if you're a nurse or a physician, or you're whatever you are, if you're doing what God's called you to do, you can't rise any higher. Billy Graham said, I'm an evangelist for God. I could never stoop to be president of the United States. Billy Graham was often asked thousands of times, millions of times. would you ever consider being president of the United States? That has always been his answer. He said, God has called me to be a minister of the gospel. How could I ever stoop to be president of the United States? Now listen, when you're doing what God wants, that's exactly what God wants. Pursuing your goals or ambitions or trusting your own heart. The Bible says in Jeremiah 17, 9, the heart, the human heart, is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? The Bible tells us that as human beings, we cannot understand the feelings of our heart. Don't go by your heart. Go by the Holy Spirit's direction. Proverbs 3, 9 says, trust in the Lord with all thy heart. And lean not unto thy own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. So I just believe that it's very important for us that we make sure that you and I are listening to the Father. And Jesus said, I want you to follow me. There is an indescribable joy when you get up in the morning and you know you're doing with your life what God called you to do, what God really wants you to do. Have any of you, I don't want you to raise your hand or anything, but have any of you ever made a wrong job decision? Have you ever made a real bad business decision? You know when you make a bad decision, it steals and it robs your joy. Well, I'm going to tell you the greatest thing that I have ever had in my life. Not that I've made a lot of mistakes, people, and I want you to know, hear me say, I have messed up a lot of you guys in my life. But I want to tell you, my heart is always raced back to Jesus when he will not let me roam only to the end of the short road, and then he'll yank my chain and pull me right back up. And my heart always, oh God, I'm sorry, I forgive, I don't ever want to wander. But when you're walking with the Lord in the light of His Word, the old man says, when we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His good will, He abides with us still and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy. John, the apostle, wrote over in 1 John chapter 1 and down in verse 4, he said, the reason that we're writing this to you, believers, is that your joy might be full. I want to tell you what a hallelujah life, child of God, you're going to have when you turn the leadership and the lordship of your life over to Him. And you say, God, the desire of my heart is not to be wealthy. It is not to be famous. It is not that I will have be the most popular person in the world. It is not that I'm going to have this and that item of success. But, oh God, may I have the joy of the Lord. I've told you this many times because it is true many times. I have had people who are worth millions and millions of dollars sitting within a few feet from me in my office or their home someplace, and they have said, I would gladly give up all the money and all the wealth I had ever accumulated and the prestige and the power that I had in my role and my work and what I did if I could just have the peace of the Lord or the joy of the Lord. I will tell you, it's a great thing when you get up every morning and you have the joy of the Lord in your soul. I'm so glad when I was a little kid, God, led me to visit a little country church. And the pastor came up to me after the service and he stuck his hand out. I was only a little 8-year-old boy. And he said, what's your name, son? I said, my name is Charlie. And he said, well, Charlie, we're sure glad to have you. And I'll tell you, that began a journey with my pastor until he died at age 92 or 93, just a few years ago. I've never seen a pastor like my pastor who had the joy of the Lord. I never saw people harass all the time. I saw him get blamed for things he didn't do. I saw him chucking in all kinds of things that do across that span of many, many years. But I never saw him without the joy of the Lord. And I've always wanted that in my life. And God has always given that in my life. But I can hardly wait. When I go to bed at night, to get up the next morning, I may be tired out and exhausted. I'm going to probably wait till the next morning because I know it's going to be a great day walking with Jesus. And God has been so good. And so there's an indescribable joy in serving Christ. And He wants you and me to finish our course with joy. I think about the missionaries, many of the missionaries that we have had here, and some who are coming this next week. Each and every one of them, I know, have the joy of the Lord. It's a mark. You know why? Because one of the great gifts of the Holy Spirit, fruits of the Holy Spirit, the fruits of the Spirit are love, joy, peace, long-suffering. Oh, and he goes on with that joy. It is a fruit of the Holy Spirit. If your roots are planted down and you're growing in the Lord, the fruits of the Spirit are, you are going to have the joy of the Lord. Oh, it doesn't mean you're not going to have problems. Listen, it doesn't mean you're not going to get sick. Listen, it doesn't mean that you're not going to die. It just means that while you're living, God's going to give you the radiant joy. When I'm praying about my life, I'm praying about God. I'm not asking for an abundance of years, but I'm asking that I might be filled with the Holy Spirit, and may I be filled with the fruits of the Spirit. May I always reflect Jesus. May I always glorify Lord Jesus. If somebody pats me on the back, Lord, I'm passing it on to you. I'm reaching on to pat you on the back and say, way to go, God. In me, that is in my flesh, if Paul said it to, there dwells no good thing. But He is the one who touches our life. He's the one who pours the water of life on us and causes us to bloom and blossom and bear fruit for Him. And He says, if you'll follow me, I'm going to give you the joy of the Holy Spirit. And the joy of the Lord is going to be a sign of your strength. I believe when we look into the gospel and we see the people in Israel there running with a mixed multitude, I believe there are oftentimes many, many things that cause our hearts to stumble. I think about the difficulty that some people have when they're even thinking about the mission field, because people are thinking, I would have to leave my comfort zone. We talked about last week, that's what happened to the people in Jerusalem, where the early church was first founded, and where Jesus was seen for 40 days and 40 nights by the early church after His resurrection. We see that they had fallen in love with being part of the church in Jerusalem when Jesus had told them out on Mount Olives before His ascension into heaven just a few weeks earlier. Jesus said, go and teach all nations. You got a problem when God says, go and teach all nations, and then you're sitting up here and say, I don't want to stay. I don't want to go. I got my wife here, kids here, in-laws went down the road. You know, I've got a good paying job, and I've got everything going on. The only problem with that is it's a problem. It's a big problem. It's always been. When the church gets Some churches are going to close down forever. Other churches will stop because of this. It's not a problem for God. But if you and me are so accustomed to our comfort zone, if we always do what we, you know that. If we always do what we've always done, we'll always get what we always got. Were we getting before the pandemic hit, were we getting what God wanted? Or had we just settled in and got confident? Now I want to ask you this morning. If some of these difficulties, some of these struggles may come into your life, you don't want to go to the mission field and you kind of close that door and you say, okay, God, what's your number two choice? What's your number three choice? The early church in Jerusalem loved Jesus. They followed him, served him, believed in him. They saw him crucified and buried, and they saw him after his resurrection. They were totally excited about living for him, but it took persecution, the death of some of their family members, the loss of their homes, in order for them to go and obey God. Some people struggle because they love this present world. And the Bible says in 1 John 2:15 through 17, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. You can't fall in love with the system, guys. You can't fall in line and say, well, I was born here, that must mean I'm going to die here. If the early church had felt that way, God, we never had a church. Number three, the challenge to trust God for our direction and provision if we want to walk in it by faith. It's hard for us to transition, isn't it? It's hard for us to learn how to take our eyes off of a good salary, a good job, a good life, and say, God, I want to walk by faith. The challenge to trust God for our direction. And then the constant attacks by Satan when we choose to obey Christ's commands. The Bible says it's going to be an endless battle, Ephesians 6:10 through 18. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand the attacks of the enemy. And number five, the significance of what Jesus said when he began calling his disciples. Jesus said in Matthew 4:17 through 20, follow me and I will make you become fishers of men. And they forsook all and followed him. Well, when I look at this, I think, what do we do? Just starting again. What's starting again look like? I know when I was a 17-year-old boy, I put everything I had in a little 1960-something Volkswagen. Drove off 1,000 miles to go to Florida. I started to live all over again. Didn't know a soul then. And then when I finished there, I went back, and then I went to Florida again under the direction of the Holy Spirit. I knew just a small handful of people because I had preached in that church before. And God called me there. It was starting life all over. I've had some shutdowns in life because we've all had things. You've lost something that was dear and precious. You've had startups, closed downs. But I want to tell you, what is it? I think it all goes back to what we talked about in the book of Judges with Shamgar, the second or third judge of Israel, and the success secrets of Shamgar. Start where you are. Use what you have. Do what you can. I think it's real easy for us as Christians, followers of the Lord, to come up with all the excuses that we can't do something for God. I love the three success secrets of Shamgar. First of all, I love them because they're in the Word of God. Secondly, I love them because of the Word. Thirdly, I love them because they're true. Start where you are. Use what you have. Do what you can. Start where you are. Oftentimes you go, well, if I lived it, no, it's not where you live. Start where you are. got up and began to read it to you guys last week on the statistics page. 22 million internationals visit the U.S. each year. 630,000 are university students in 220 countries. 25% of those countries prohibit Christian missionaries. 80% of those students will return back to their own countries having never been invited into an American home. Just again, speak to my heart. Did he speak to anybody else last week with that? If he did, he got one. I couldn't have bored anything about that. I'm what, 25 minutes from half state. I've gone over and taken the international students on the buses and some of the rest of you guys. We've taken them to Walmart and the barbecue. But I've never had anybody to my home. I thought about this one. 40% of the world's 220 heads of state once studied in the United States. 90% of international students are unreached by any ministry while in the United States. American Christians spend 95% of their offerings on home-based ministry and only 0.5% to reach the unreached. You know, I'm just going to close off with this scripture. I had so much more to do with it. Mission times next week. We don't have time to just have conversations and talk. But I wanted to share something out of Matthew chapter 25, if you want to turn over there with me. Because I think that this is exactly what Jesus was talking about when he was speaking in Matthew 25, down in verse 31. And Jesus was talking. He said, when I, the Son of Man, shall come in his glory and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory. And before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another as the shepherd divides his sheep from the goats. And he shall set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on the left. And then the king shall say to them on his right hand, come ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. And then he lists off these things. For I was hungry, and you gave me meat. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger. What was he saying? I was from out of town. I was up at the church parking lot earlier this morning, and there was a man and his wife wandering around the parking lot out there. I didn't know who they were, so I went over there and introduced myself. And when the guy started talking, I said, you're not from here. He laughed. He said, no, I'm not. I said, you're from Ohio. He said, pretty close. He said, Michigan. I said, but I didn't know anybody could steal a table. I said, oh, no, it jumps out at me. He said, but you know what he was saying? He was a stranger to me. But you know what also is true? Every one of those international students at App State University is strangers in our land. I was a stranger, and you took me in. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to see me. And then shall the righteous say unto Jesus, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and take you in, or naked and clothed you? Or when did we see you sick or in prison and came unto thee? And then the king shall answer and say unto them, verily I say unto you, inasmuch as you have done it unto one of the least of these my brethren, you have done it unto me. The guy, I'm going to tell you what. I've never really had any racial problems in my life. The early church faced racial problems. And I'm going to tell you, you know what carried them when they did what God told them to do? church, if just the church of Jesus Christ, just believers in Christ, if we took that text right there and we practiced that, not just in our life, but in our church, we make sure everybody knows you are wanted, you are welcome, you are loved, you are accepted, you are important, you are necessary, you are God's gift to Bethel Church. When you walk in our doors, I will tell you what, we're going to fall in love with you, and you're going to fall in love with us. And I will tell you, whatever happened to racial problems when we do it God's way? Is there an amen in the house? It just comes a matter of putting it in trust. And I think when we do this, that we begin to look around and I think about one of the things you got to tell you. I said, God, put something in my let me be creative. God, I'm an old man, but I want to be creative. God, get some. You give me the ideas. God, you always give me. If I've ever had a good idea, it came from you. God, give me some. And I got to thinking about the early church in Acts 8. When people were in need, you know what the people did? They said, those that had houses and lands, obviously, that they weren't using, they sold it and they brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. And, hey, I want to ask you, because God spoke to me about this. Hey, Charlie, you got any laying around here that's got value, but you don't use it anymore? I said, oh, I've done stuff like that. He said, I want you to sell it and give the money to missions. I said, I'm going to throw that out to you. Anybody else out there to raise your hand? I'm going to be the only one who got all kinds of stuff laying around. I wouldn't miss it if somebody sold it. And whatever I get for it, I can give it to our missions. We've got people, Alex is leading the trip. I know Chuck wanted to go too and be a part of that if it works to do next year a mission trip. I've heard Ivan and Chad talking about the possibility of a mission trip. I want to tell you, Peter and Viviana are going to invite Bethel to partake a mission trip to a Lutheran or to St. Lucia, Bahamas, to come see world missions there on this island in the Bahamas. What could we do to start a fund that would fund our young people and our young adults going to a mission field, some of them for the very first time, to see firsthand world missions? I'll tell you, I want that for our young people, I want it for our children, and I want you and me over people. You know, we can't take it with us. The Bible says the love of money is the root of all evil. We can't, none of us who came into this world with nothing, we're going to go home with nothing. What are you going to do? I start a trial tomorrow on Zoom. First time this has ever happened to me in working with the Wills Trust and estate plans. But we have a tremendous, massive gift given to the college. And 3.5 years ago, the people died. And a relative, a distant relative, contested the trial. And now we're going to wait to see, is the judge going to say the money can go where the people wanted it to go, or is it going to go where the judge decides that it goes? Now, if you were dying and you already made your will, and the judge threw your will out, and he said, I'm going to decide who would you want to be that judge. You would want it. You want what you say in your will to be done. Now, listen, here's what God's saying to you and me. You didn't come in here with anything. When you go home, you're not going to take it. What are you going to do with what he gave you while you're living? You can take care of that. I want to challenge you. You think of some creative things. And some of you teenagers, think of some creative ideas. Help them on morning for your great goodness. Thank you for your love. God, I pray for our missionaries coming in next Saturday. They're going to be coming in. I pray for the conference. God, you know that everything that seems like on my end, God, everything that could go wrong has gone wrong. And our fulfilling the things that we wanted to do. But God, I don't care about anything that I want to do. God, but I pray everything you want to happen will ultimately take place. Right till a day ago, we didn't know exactly where everything was going to be headed. We'll be here next Sunday morning, but then just kind of take what comes. But God, would you just be in charge? Would you bring everybody here safely? God, would you see to it that the very ones, God, you want to be here will come and just be here to encourage, just to listen to the missionary's story, just to encourage them, just to bless their lives. And God, would you ever, sometimes would you speak to me? I'm the one that's calling out to the Lord, not my brother, not my sister, but it's still, Lord, standing in need of prayer. I pray, God, that you will speak to my heart in the missionary conference and speak to the hearts of the church. Help us, God, as a church, to start where we are, use what we have, and do what we can. Lord, if there's one person here this morning that has never settled their eternal destiny, God, they don't know you as Lord of their life, I pray that this morning they would be saved. God, if you're reaching out and touching one human life here this morning, calling, touching their heart about being open to following you wherever you lead their past in life, God, would you speak to their heart as you spoke to my heart when I was a little 8-year-old child, God, I didn't understand much that night. But I knew you.